Go into any Judaica shop before Passover, and you'll see little plastic lice and little toy frogs and red food dye to drop into your water and pretend your water is turning into blood. It always strikes me as so odd that we turn the plagues into the fun part of the Seder, when in fact it's the most gruesome part of the story. In fact, maybe that's part of the point, actually, because it's the most uncomfortable part. As we read through the plagues this week in Parshat Va'era, we realize that what we want is to believe in the God of compassion, the one who hears our cries and frees us from Egypt. And this is the hard part, because what do we do with the God of brimstone who's bringing hail and plagues and darkness and death of the firstborn? What do we do with that God? The Midrash has the problem that we have too. In Midrash Tanhuma, they go through, the rabbis go through each of the plagues and assign for each one a cause, a sin, something that the Egyptians did wrong that would merit their being punished with the plague. So for example, the death of the firstborn is justified because Pharaoh, some chapters earlier, killed the Israelite babies as they were born. So it's actually not, they argue, the rabbis are arguing here, unfair at all. They go through each of the plagues with one exception. And the exception is, for me, very meaningful. The exception is the plague of darkness. I'll share with you the Midrash. Why did God, before whom there is no favoritism, and who examines the heart and tests emotions, bring the plague of darkness upon the Egyptians? Because among Israel, there were transgressors who had Egyptian patrons and who lived in affluence and honor, and so they did not want to leave Egypt. The Holy One, blessed be He, said, "If I bring a plague upon them openly, from which they will die, the Egyptians will claim, just as we were afflicted, so too they, those Israelites, were afflicted." Therefore, God brought darkness upon the Egyptian for 3 days. One person could not see another, but all of the children of Israel had light in their dwellings. What I love about this Midrash is that it acknowledges that there are those of us in Israel and in Egypt and everywhere who just don't always get it right. It acknowledges that even the good guys of the story need God's compassion, that God plays no favorites between the Egyptians and the Israelites. And so we can read the story as one of strict justice, going through the plagues and finding the reason. But when we get to darkness, we realize this is also a story about God's compassion. That God, as the Midrash says, knows what is in our hearts, knows our emotions, and so understands our actions from the inside out. God understands what was going on inside when we did that terrible thing. And what does God do? God brings darkness. Darkness, which we experience in our own lives as depression, the inability to see a light, to have hope, a darkness that falls over us emotionally when we do the wrong thing. But in the story, this darkness also grants a cover for God and for the Israelites that will ultimately lead to redemption and to a freedom. This cover is what enables God to free the Israelites, to punish those who are truly wrongdoing, who truly do not deserve the merit of being liberated. But also, perhaps, I like to imagine those 3 days of darkness in the Egyptian camp is what enables God to give to the Israelites a little bit of time, maybe a chance, those 3 more days to do tshuva, to change their ways from the inside out. From darkness, that last of the plagues before the ultimate last of the plagues, the death of the firstborn, that darkness is the turning point of the story. After that darkness, there is no going back. Freedom is the next part of the story. Our darkest moments are the ones that enable us to see the light, to return to a path in which we can celebrate God as the God of harsh justice, but also as a God of compassion who hears our cries for help and brings us out of darkness into light, into freedom.